up to this memory organization of 8051. Okay. So before going to memory organization, so we should be aware of PSW register. So what is this PSW register? It stands for Program Status Word Register. So in our architecture diagram, we have seen that if you add 2 plus 3, okay, the result will be stored in accumulator, and the status flags, okay, the flags which are affected, that can be displayed, or their status can be seen in our PSW, Program Status Word. So it is a bit addressable register. What is the meaning of bit addressable register? That means individually you can program this particular bit, OVR bit, okay, you can program this parity bit, okay, individually you can program this auxiliary carry bit. So that is the specialty of this register. This is what bit addressable register. Okay, what are the contents here? So first bit is what? Parity bit. So it is also written as PSW.0, PSW.2, PSW.3, so on. Okay, so I'm starting from left hand side. Okay, left hand side. So you're saying what? Carry flag. So carry flag, you are very aware of this thing. When the carry will be set, so the example is given here. Okay, if I'm adding all ones with all zeros, what is happening? All ones with one, FF plus one. So what you will get? You will get a carry here. So here you have generated a carry. Because of that reason, what will happen? This carry bit will be set. Okay, clear with that? And the second thing is what? Auxiliary carry. So it will be set to one when carry is occurring from lower nibble to higher nibble. Okay, it is very clear, and it is also occurring in this example. Okay, so because of this reason, what will happen? It will be set to one. Next flag is what? User defined flag or general purpose flag. So that means by program or because of result, this will not be affected. So you, it is up to you as a program, it is up to you. You can clear it or you can set using this instruction, set bit PSW.5. Okay, so what happens? This flag will be set. Okay, if you want to clear, you can use this instruction, clear PSW.5. Okay, it is up to you. It is a user defined or general purpose flag. Okay, now coming to these things, RS1 and RS0, okay, both are commonly used. So what is the purpose of using them commonly? So using these two registers, you can generate four combinations. Based on the four combinations, you can select a bank. Okay, so 00 will give you bank 0, similarly bank 1, bank 2 and bank 3. So what are these banks? So these are what? Register banks. Okay, these are what? Register banks. So where these banks are available? These banks are available in internal RAM. So I will explain in detail where these banks are available and how they are used, okay, in coming slides. Okay, leaving this bit, overflow bit, okay, this is overflow flag. So I will explain this later. So next bit is what? Don't care. That means we are not using this particular bit. Okay, now coming to what is the last bit? Or in the, it is a starting bit. PSW0 is starting bit. Parity bit. Unlike our processor, what will happen in our processor? If it is having, if the result is having even number of ones, then parity will become one in processor. But here it is quite different. So if the result is having, see, if the result is having odd number of ones, that is what? Odd parity, and it will be set to one. Okay, P will be set to one. And if the result is having even number of ones, then it is what? Even parity, and it will be indicated by zero. Then P will be cleared to zero. Okay, so there are four types of parity. Number of ones, then they are even, you can consider even parity, or number of zeros when they are even number, you can consider even parity. Similarly, odd number of ones, odd number of zeros. Okay, so here in processor and in controller, they are different. Okay, so once again, coming to parity, if you have odd number of ones in your result, then odd parity will be generated, P will be set to one. Okay, if you are having even number of ones, then what will happen? Parity bit will be set to zero. Okay, now coming to this overflow. So in processor also we have seen overflow. The same overflow concept will be applicable here. What is overflow here? So in general we have a wrong idea. Okay, we have a weird idea that Here, consider this example. So this bit is having 8 bits. What is happening? An extra carry is generated. So that 9th bit is coming outside. It is overflowing. Okay, overflowing from this register. So this is the wrong idea or wrong notion about overflow. So this is completely wrong. Okay, overflow is a different thing. Okay, overflow means, okay, overflow will be set when you need to have some knowledge about signed numbers and unsigned numbers. Okay, so it is related to signed numbers. If the range of the signed numbers, what is the range of signed numbers? Okay, I will explain in detail. Okay, I will consider next slide to explain these things. So consider range of signed numbers in general. Okay, for unsigned numbers, this 1, 2, 3, 8 bits. So 8 bits are used for magnitude. Okay, 8 bits are used for magnitude. That means 2 power 8. That means it can be ranging from 0 to 256 numbers. Unsigned means definitely it is positive. There is no question of negative. Okay, so definitely they are what? Positive numbers. They will start from 0 and end with 256. But now we are discussing about signed numbers. That means how you will identify it is a positive number or negative number. So we are reserving one bit here as a signed bit. So this bit will indicate if it is 1, the number is what? Negative number. If this signed bit is 0, the remaining number is what? It is a positive number. So this 7 bits will give you magnitude, 1 bit will give you the sign, or it is indicating it is a positive or negative number. 7 bits. So what should be the range? Okay, so I am starting from 0. Okay, 0 will be the first, and 0 to 2 power 7 will be maximum, but I have started with 0. So what will be the answer? 2 power 7 minus 1. Okay, so the range for positive numbers is 0 to 127. For negative numbers, so already we have used 0 in positive numbers, so we will start with negative, minus 1 to exactly minus 128. So what will be the total range? It will start from minus 128 to minus 1, 0 to 127. This will be the total range of signed numbers. Okay, so how I am indicating in hexadecimal 00, and this will be indicated as 7F, whereas 128 will be indicated as 80H. Okay, you can convert if you have any doubt. Okay, that is not a big deal. Okay, now if the result, you have done some addition operation, if the result is greater than this range, okay, if the result is out of this range, that means you have generated minus 81 number or positive 80. If the result is greater than 7F or lesser than minus 80, then overflow flag will set, indicating that your answer has overflown from the range. Okay, see here, I have written very clearly here, overflow. What is the meaning of overflow? It means the result of the result has overflown the range of the signed numbers. What is the range of the signed numbers? That is, if you consider here in hexadecimal, it is from minus 80 to plus 7F, or minus 128 to plus 127. Okay, I will consider an example to explain it in detail. Now consider here 42 plus 43. So if you add this, what will be the answer? 85. So let us see in binary. So 0100 and 0010 will be 42. 0100 and 00111 will be 43. If you add this thing, what you will get? It is 8, and it is what? 5. 85. But you see here, this 85, it is within the range or it is coming out of the range? Just see the range here once. Okay, the range is up to 7F or minus 80. Okay, minus 80 or plus 7F. But it is what? Positive 85. That is, it has come out of this range. That means overflow flag will set, indicating that your result, your answer has come out of this particular range. Okay, we understand this, that the overflow has occurred by seeing the range. But how the processor will understand? Will it understand? Okay, every time it will check it is in minus 128 to plus 7F or some other thing? No, it won't check in that manner. It needs a mathematical formula to evaluate the answers. So for that, microprocessor will decide overflow by XORing C6, carry 6 and carry 7. Okay, by XORing carry 6 and carry 7. So what is this carry 6 and carry 7? You can see here. Okay, starting with LSB bit. Okay, if the carry is occurring from this LSB bit to first bit, this carry is named as C0. Okay, from first bit to second bit, C1. Second to third, C2, similarly C3, similarly C4, C5, C6, okay, this is C6. if the carry is occurring from MSB bit and it is coming out, okay, from MSB to out, that is carry. So that is named as C7, okay, C6 and C7. So I mean the processor will verify, okay, by XORing C6 and C7, okay, then it will understand that, okay, overflow has occurred or overflow has not occurred. So in this case, okay, for this example, what are the answers? What are the answers? So what will be the status of PSW? Okay, see here, in our case, what has happened? Has the carry generated? Anything has come out of MSB bit? 0 plus, here 1 plus 0, it is 1. No carry has generated. So C7 is what? 0. Or carry bit is what? 0. So I have mentioned here, carry is what? 0. And next thing, auxiliary carry, that means from lower nibble to higher nibble, that is 1. That is C3. Have you generated auxiliary carry here? No. So the auxiliary carry bit will be 0. Has the overflow occurred? Because of our using our common sense and knowing the range, we can say overflow has occurred. But how the processor will decide? It will XOR C6 and C7. You see here, the carry has generated here C6. 1 plus 1 is 0 plus 1. So the C6 carry is generated, but C7 carry has not generated. So 1 XOR 0, it will be 1. So in XOR, if two inputs are different, then definitely we will get the answer as 1. So here, XOR, the overflow has generated. Coming to parity, see here, parity 1, 2 and 3, odd number of 1s. If odd number of 1s means odd parity, that is P will be set to 1. So here it is indicating P has set to 1. So I think it is very, very clear how you are deciding overflow, how we are deciding overflow and how the processor is deciding overflow. Processor is deciding using the formula C6 XOR C7, and we can decide using this formula as well as if we are aware of the range, simply you can decide. If it is greater than 7F, overflow has occurred. If it is lesser than minus 128, overflow has occurred. Okay. Now, see here. So once again, I have drawn the same thing. Okay. But concentrate here, RS1 and RS0. Okay. So using these combinations, you have generated four banks, four memory banks. Okay. So I will indicate where the memory banks are available. Okay, first of all, I will show where the banks are available. This is your internal RAM. Internal RAM is of 128 bytes. Okay, so first 32 bytes. So we will generally, we will start addressing any memory, we will start addressing from lower address. So from smaller values, we will go upwards. From smaller head to higher head, okay? From smaller values to higher in this fashion, increasing order. So 00 will be here, and in this fashion you will be increasing, and up to 7F. 7F is what? 127. That means 00 to 127 means totally 128 bytes. So first 32 bytes are reserved for banks. Okay, are reserved for banks. So bank 0, then bank 1, bank 2 and bank 3. Okay, internally each of these banks will be having 8 registers, R0 to R7. Once again, bank 1 will be having R0 to R7. Once again, bank 2 will be having R0 to R7. Similarly, bank 3 will be having R0 to R7. So these 32 bits are available at starting addresses of our internal RAM. Clear with this thing? Okay. Why need these banks? What is the purpose of having these banks? The question arises. Now I am answering that question. See here. What is the need of bank? Okay. Suppose I am writing a instruction, move A, R0. Similarly, you can move A, R1, move A, R7. Up to R7, you can use these registers and you can write same instruction. But see here, for this instruction, one opcode will be generated, and this opcode will be different from the opcode which is generated for this instruction. Why? So what is opcode? So it is very basic thing we have already learned in our microprocessor, but still I'm helping you. So opcode will define the type of operation performed. So what type of operation you are performing? Move operation. But what is happening when the assembler, okay, you are writing in assembly language, when the assembler is converting into machine language, so a specific code of binary digits, ones and zeros, a specific code will be generated. That particular code is named as opcode. Okay, so for this particular instruction, one opcode will be generated. So that opcode will be different from this instruction, and this second opcode will be different from third one. Similarly, so what is the idea? What is the idea? Here I want to say that you are generating 8 different opcodes for move instruction. Okay, how many registers are available? Okay, totally 32 registers are available. How? See here. So R0 to R7 for bank 0, they are 8. For bank 1, once again 8. Overall, how many registers are available? 32. Okay. So 32 different registers are available. If I am starting and writing these instructions, move A, R0 for bank 1, bank 2, bank 3, and similarly for R. Continuation up to 32 means I will start with R8, R9, R similarly up to R32. That means I need how many opcodes here? For only move instruction, I need 32 different opcodes here. Okay, coming to add instruction, similar thing. Okay, for add, it will generate an opcode. Add A, R1, add A, R2. Similarly, you are having what? 32 different opcodes for add instruction. Similarly for subtraction, 32. Similarly for multiplication, similarly for division. So number of opcodes will be increasing, okay? But how many opcodes are available for you? Okay, internally you are using 8-bit microprocessor. That means 2 power 8 will give you 256 opcodes. Only available opcodes for your microcontroller is what? 2 power 8, that is 256. But in this fashion, if you are generating the opcodes, so for add, subtract, multiply, divide, so 32 into 4, so that many number will be used. And some of the instructions are available. Move, okay, add with carry, okay, subtract with borrow. So if you are using these instructions, your 256 opcodes will not be sufficient, and that is not an effective method of using your opcodes. So to avoid that thing, we are using the concept of banks, okay? So we are using the concept of banks now, okay? I think what is the need of banks is clear, okay? So to avoid this 32 number of opcodes for move instruction and 32 opcodes for add, 32 for subtract, and similarly, to avoid all those number of opcodes, okay, we are going for banks. So how these banks are helping us? Okay, now see, I'm using bank 0. So bank 0 is having how many registers? 8 registers, from starting from R0 to R7, okay? So I have generated 8 different opcodes here by selecting what? By selecting RS1 and RS0 as 00. Okay. Now I will program this RS1 and RS0 as 01. So what will be selected? B1 will be selected here. So now these combinations, the same opcodes are used here for these registers, but the bank is different. That means I am using only 8 opcodes for a move instruction to address bank 0, bank 1, bank 2, and bank 3. So now the number of opcodes used are decreased. So initially, how many number of opcodes are used for only move instruction? 32 for different registers. But now I'm using the concept of banks. So when the combination of RSN1 and RS0 is 00, bank 0 is selected. So these opcodes, okay, move A, R0 to move A, R7. So opcodes are generated. These opcodes are designating your bank 0. Now if I have used the combination 01, the same opcodes are addressing, or the same opcodes are using specifying the move instruction for bank 1. Okay, same opcodes can be used for bank 2, same opcodes can be used for bank 3 by using the combination 11. So because of this particular reason, we are going for the concept of banks. I think it is very, very clear. Okay, you can see here once again 256 opcodes are available, but if you don't use the concept of banks, so 32 opcodes will be used for add, 32 will be for subtraction, so 32 for move, and so on. So to avoid that thing, I am using banks. By using these banks, okay, move A, R0 up to move A, R7, so 8 opcodes are available. So these same opcodes will serve the purpose for bank 0 if the combination is 00. Same opcodes will serve the purpose for bank 1 if the combination is 01. Same opcodes can be used if the combination is 10, that is selecting bank 2. Okay, I think the concept is very, very clear. Now coming to memory organization. So why we have learned about program status, what means? So the need of memory banks can be clearly understood and the same concept of memory banks will be used in our memory organization. So because to have some clarity how the banks are used, what is the purpose of banking, so that thing I have explained, and with this you can clearly understand this internal structure of RAM. Okay, I will start with, I hope it is very very clear. Okay, now I will start the actual concept of memory organization. So when you are saying about memory, so what are the things which comes in your mind? So definitely you will come across four things: internal RAM, internal ROM, external ROM and external RAM. Okay, four things are available. So as a programmer you can use all four things, it's up to you. You can use only internal RAM or internal RAM plus external RAM, or only internal ROM plus or internal ROM and external ROM, it's up to you. But how to use those things, I will explain each and everything in detail. So first thing I am going with ROM. Okay, first thing I am going with ROM. So what is ROM? ROM is also called program memory or code memory. So what you are storing in that, so the programs which are essential and every time they are used, that kind of programs are stored in our ROM. They can be only read, they can't be rewritten. Okay, once they are written they can't be touched. So I have taken the example that in yesterday's class, okay, in the previous class, when you are starting your computer or your laptop, so that desktop has to be ready with some icons, that icons has to be displayed. So background work, so for that a program will be available, that program will be stored in your ROM. Every time when you open your laptop, that thing has to be read. Okay, that is read from your ROM. Okay, first thing, I am using only my internal ROM. Okay, we have seen in our previous class that internal ROM capacity is 4 KB. Okay, 4 KB, so what will be the addresses generated for this? Okay, 4 KB means how many digits it can use. 4 in 4 KB means K is 2 power 10, here it will be 2 power 2, so combinedly you will be using 2 power 12 bits. So all 12 bits starting from 0 to all 12 bits with ones, so 000 to fff it is enough. But as per standard we are following 16 bits, so I am starting with all four zeros but I am ending with 0 and 3 f's. Okay, so it is clear I am using only ROM, I am interested only in my ROM, I am using only my ROM, I am not touching external ROM. Okay, now in the second case, if I am using internal RAM plus external ROM, how? Okay, so in yesterday's in the previous class I have mentioned in features that expandable memory, the total memory of ROM can be expandable, it can be expanded up to 64 KB. So how the 64 KB is utilized here, see. Okay, internal plus external, so internal ROM, I am starting with my internal ROM, so what is the address of this internal ROM? All four zeros to 0FFF, plus the next address should be started from what? 0FFF plus 1, that means 1000. So it should start from 1000 and it should end up to all f's. Okay, so but we have seen in our previous class that expandable memory is up to 64 KB. So what you might have understood, so the external ROM capacity would be 64 KB, so that is wrong. Okay, so that you, I think you should not understand in the manner. So expandable means you total memory should be of 64 KB. So if you have understood it is having 64 KB, that is wrong. So already you have used 4 KB here, so what you are left with, you are left with only 60 KB. okay, so total address, so if you are starting with internal plus external, total memory is what? 64 KB, that is okay. But when you are coming to internal, it is using 4 KB and external is using 60 KB. So the addresses are starting from all the way from 000 to all f's, completely 64 KB. So the third case, okay, now coming to third case, what is the third case? I am interested to use only external ROM. Okay, fourth case will be I am not using ROM at all, so that is not possible, because definitely if you are using your laptop or if you are using your computer, definitely if you are starting your computer, background work has to be done, for that programs are needed, definitely they are to be read from ROM. So definitely either you have to use internal ROM, internal plus external, or the third option is external ROM. Okay, so you should get a question first, please concentrate here, instead of going to this thing, first you should get the question that, sir, why I need to use external ROM? Okay, you have said that when I am opening my computer, okay, when you are opening your computer, definitely you need some programs to start your computer, okay, boost up the computer and set up the desktop, gives display the icons. For that you need your programs that are written in ROM. What ROM? Internal ROM. But you are saying you are discarding internal ROM and you are using only external ROM. How is it possible? Okay, if you start thinking, definitely you should get a doubt, how I can access my computer without using internal ROM. Okay, so the background will not be set, the icons will not be displayed, you will get this question. But the answer is, see, you will update your mobile phone for every 3 to 4 months. Okay, everyone will update. So what is happening when you are updating your mobile phone? That means the ROM contents, the contents of the ROM will be the programs which you have initially stored in your internal ROM. Okay, that similar programs will be in an updated fashion. Some features will be added in that thing. But can you store the updated program in your internal ROM? No, the answer is no, because internal ROM, once you have written in that something, you can't touch that ROM. Simply you can read the content. So here I am updating my phone means I am updating the ROM. I am updating the programs. So I can't write that programs in my internal ROM. But instead of that, I have another option, that my updated programs, I can store the updated programs in my external ROM. Okay. So then what I will do? I need to get a desktop in a new fashion. Okay. The changes, updated features must be displayed. So for that reason, I need to discard. Otherwise, what will happen if you are using internal ROM? What will happen? Your desktop will be get ready by the previous programs, and in the same manner it will be displayed. But you wanted the updated features to be displayed. So for that reason, what you will do? You will discard. You will not use internal ROM. Simply you will use external ROM. Okay. How it is possible? Okay. This is possible because of using with the help of the pin external access enable. So in the previous class we have seen in internal architecture diagram in timing and control unit, there is a pin called EA bar pin. EA bar stands for external access enable. That means if this pin external access bar is equal to zero, that means this external access is selected. That means you are discarding, you are not using internal ROM, and simply you are going with external ROM. That is the meaning of this thing. Okay, see here, what is the meaning? EA bar equal to zero means, see, we are discarding internal ROM, so total 64 KB will be utilized in the external ROM itself. Okay, so all the addresses will start from all zeros to all FFF. Okay, so this thing completely, it will give you 64 KB. Okay, clear with this thing? And one more thing, you might have observed this thing. So EA bar equal to zero means definitely you are using only the external ROM. You are not using internal ROM. So in the previous cases, case one and case two, you might have noticed in this thing. So in case one, only internal. So it's up to me. I am using, if I want to inform that I am using internal RAM, EA bar should be one. Okay. And second case, EA bar is one means definitely I am using internal RAM, and in addition, I can use external ROM. Okay, EA bar equal to one means definitely I'm using internal ROM. Okay, third case, coming to third case, definitely if EA bar has selected as zero, then definitely you need to understand that you are not using internal ROM. Okay, why these things are happening? Okay, why the need comes here? Suppose, see here, I am taking the example 0125H. Suppose I want to access an address, if the microprocessor want to access an address 0125H. So that thing will be available in case 2 as well as in case 3. Okay. See, case 2 and case 3. Let us see here, case 2. So 0125H, where it will be available? So here it will be 0125H. It will be available in case 2, this one. And the same address you can get in case 3. Okay. Here also, somewhere here you will get 0125H. If EA bar pin is not used, then what will happen? The microcontroller will get confused. So whether to access this particular memory location from external ROM or to access 0125 memory location, which is available in internal ROM, so it gets confused. To avoid that confusion, what we need to do, we need to take the help of EA bar pin. If EA bar pin equal to 1, you are using that 0125 address from internal ROM. Clear? If I have selected EA bar equal to 0, that 0125 is available in my external ROM. So to differentiate that address, so I'm using the pin EA bar. Okay. Coming to RAM, we have discussed about ROM. Now I'm discussing about RAM. See here. So how we are starting our memory? How we will address? We will start from bottom and we will move to top. Okay. So the address is from 00s to 0FF, which will give you 4KB, and from that remaining will be 60KB. Okay. Suppose if EA bar equal to 1, that means what? I am using my internal RAM. Okay. Internal ROM. So this 4KB will be of internal ROM, and then if necessary, if you are using only this thing, it will be case 1. Okay. Second case is what? EA bar equal to 1 internal plus external, that means you are using 4KB internal plus external 4KB. Okay. Third thing, if EA bar equal to 0, that means you are using only the external ROM, so you are discarding this thing, then the new addresses will come into play. That means all the way from 000 to all FF, that means it will be of 64KB. Okay. Now here you are having internal RAM. Now coming to RAM, internal RAM is of 128 bytes and external ROM is of 64KB. So you will get a doubt. Okay, sir, we have used internal and external, only internal or only external in our ROM. So will that cases will the same cases arrive in our RAM? Come on, guess by yourself. Okay, so what is the answer? The answer will be no. Why? What is the reason, sir? See, I have taken the example of 0125H in our ROM, and I have seen that you can get the same address in this particular area, or if you are working with third case, you can get in this particular area. So you, the processor, the controller will get confused to whether to access this memory location or this. So that, because of that, we are going with EA bar pin. Okay. Now here internal RAM is having what? 128 bytes. To address this, I can use only 8 bits. Okay. 00, first address will be 00 and the last address will be 7F. Okay. All the way from 0001 to last address will be 7F. Okay. And here external RAM will start from all 40s to 4FFs. Okay. So here this is different. So if you remember our internal architecture diagram, and I have sent in our sent a PDF file, in that you can clearly see that a blue color line is what it is indicating, 8 bit data as well as address. Okay, that is connected to RAM. Okay, that is carrying this address, so it will carry the contents. So the all of these memory locations, the contents will be carried by that 8 bit data bus, or that bus can also act as 8 bit address. So this 00H or 7F, these addresses will be carried by that 8 bit data or address bus. And if you observe our PDF file, in that, so the bottom line is, that is drawn by black color pen, so black ink. So I mentioned there black ink, so that black ink is indicating 16 bit address bus. So these addresses, okay, these particular addresses will be carried by that address bus. So these two are very, very different. So no concept of using no concept of discarding internal RAM and using external RAM. See here, why there is no confusion. So if you want to access 25, okay, address 25, so here you will write 25H, and here the same address, that will be written as 0025H. That means this 0025H is a different memory location, and this 25H indicated by, okay, 8 bits is a different memory location, and the one which is indicated by 16 bits is a different location. So there is no concept of EA bar, there is no concept of discarding internal RAM and using external RAM. Okay, definitely you are going to use internal RAM as well as external RAM. After using this internal, you will go with this external RAM. Clear with that? So now coming to structure of our internal RAM. So 128 bytes of, okay. So why we are learning about internal RAM? Why we are not studying the internal structure of our ROM? So ROM is inbuilt. That means once the designer, once the designer of the processor or the controller, at the time of designing, he will write some programs and he will store in ROM. You can't write the programs. Simply you can read the programs. So no matter, even if you study about that, you won't make the changes. Okay. So what is the other thing? What, where you will write the programs, temporary programs, and where you will store the data? You will definitely use RAM. So because of that reason, we are going to study the internal structure of RAM. So see here, this total things 80 plus 16 plus 32, it will give you 32 bytes of memory. Okay, it will give you 32 bytes of memory. Okay. So in that, you have three sections. First section is for banks. Second section is what? See here clearly it is written as bit addressable area as well as BA. BA is what? Byte addressable area. So this special part consisting of 16 bytes is only bit addressable as well as byte addressable area. Okay. Here this area is byte addressable. This area is also byte addressable. This area is also byte addressable. That means all the registers can be accessed in a manner of in terms of bytes. Okay, you can address these registers in terms of bytes. Okay, only this specific area can be used in terms of bits. Okay, you can address them in bit. Okay, bit wise you can address them. Okay, see here. So what is the need of these banks? I have clearly explained. To reduce number of opcodes, you can use banks. Okay, now I am starting the addresses. Okay, we will start from bottom and we will move up to top. So what will be the address? 00. You will start with 00. Why you are using only 2 bits? Why you are using internally 2 bits? Means totally 8 bits, because 2^7, that will be 128 bits. So maximum it will be 128. That can be accommodated using 8 bits. Okay, using 7 bits it is okay, but to maintain the standard we are using extra bit. So 2 zeros to 7f, total it will give you 128 bytes. See, this is byte, 1 byte, it is indicating 1 byte. 30h, it is a 1 byte memory location. Okay, all these are 1 byte memory locations. Okay, so here bank 0 will be having r0 to r7 registers. That means one r0 will be carrying the address 00. Similarly r1 will carry 01h address. Similarly r7 will carry 07h address. Bank 1 register will carry 08h address. Similarly r7 of bank 1 will carry 0f address. In this fashion you can give the addresses. Okay, and one more thing, considering this part, okay, bank register bank part, okay, I can address, okay, I can address or I can identify this register by two ways. Okay, I can address this as r7 of bank 1, okay, or I can address this as memory location whose address is 0fh. okay, so there are two ways to address any memory location, that is calling by address or calling by value or calling by name. So how you are addressing this thing? So I will take the example of our students. Okay, in general I am dealing with two classes, so bank 1, bank 2, 112 and 113. So in 112 also there will be a person by name, some, consider a name Rahul. So Rahul will be available in class 112 and he may also be available in 113, same person with same name. Okay, I will mention Rahul of 113 class, that means he will come. Okay, he will raise his hand, sir, I am the person. So if I am mentioning Rahul of 112 class, so the person, specified person, will raise the hand, sir, I am the person from 112 class, that means from bank 0. Okay, so in that manner you can differentiate. What is the other way? How I can differentiate the persons with same names? The other way is that if I want to differentiate this r7 and r7 of this bank 1, how I can differentiate? By address. Simply 113 person, the person with name Rahul in 113 class will be having a different ID number, different address. Okay, and the person with name Rahul in 112 will be having a different ID number. Okay, in our class I have taken the example that you people are memory locations and your ID numbers are your addresses. So here the same person, okay, the person with the name Rahul will be having a different address in 112, and this person with name Rahul in 113, he will be having different address. So what are the two ways to call a register here? By name or by address. So if I identify a student by ID number, that means you are calling him by address. If you are calling him by name, and you need to mention the bank. Okay. Similarly, if I'm selecting bank one, by how you can select the bank one? By using the combination of PSW registers RS1 and RS0 01. If you have selected 01, so you are addressing bank one, and if you are calling the name Rahul or R7, he will raise the hand. He will answer, okay sir, I am the person whom you are addressing. Okay, I think I am clear here. Okay, up to this point, starting address will be 00 and up to 1F. So this all bits are what? Totally they are occupying 32 bytes. They are used for storing the registers. Okay, these are what registers, sir? These are all general purpose registers. All are GPRs, general purpose registers. In 8086, how many registers are available? 14 registers are available. In that, some special purpose registers are available. 8 general purpose registers are available. Accumulator B, C, D, E, H, L. Okay, so these registers are available. Out of these registers, how many registers you can use? So there you have having 8 registers. There you are having how many? 8 registers. Okay, 8 general purpose registers. But you are having here. Okay, sorry. So there you are having 8 general purpose registers. Because of that particular reason, you can use those 8 general purpose registers in your programming. Here you are having 32 general purpose registers. So is it the advantage of having more number of general purpose registers? What is the answer? As a programmer, you need more number of general purpose registers or less number of general purpose registers? So the answer is S. So this more number of general purpose registers will help you to write the program in an easier manner. So it will help you to write programs very easily. Why? So if a register is available, directly you can load some value in a register. You can perform add or subtract operation with two registers directly. If less number of registers are available, then you need to go for addresses. You need to go for memory locations. You need to load in a memory location, and you need to get the address in your instruction, and then you need to perform some operation. That becomes tedious job. So having more number of general purpose registers is definitely an advantage, added advantage. So you can write the programs very easily. Okay, I think this part is very, very clear. First section of banks is very, very clear. Okay, coming to second part. Okay, this second part is what area? It is bit addressable area. Okay, what is the meaning of bit addressable area? So here I am having, you can see here, this is a memory location. Each memory location will be having how many address, how many bits? It is having 8 bits. Okay, each memory location will be having 8 bits. So I am, see, you can see here one first bit, second bit, third bit, and eighth bit. So each bit is each byte will be having 8 bits. Okay, so I can use these bits, or I may not use these bits. So I can address these registers or these memory locations as bytes, or I can address them as bits. It's up to me as a programmer. It's up to me. I can use them as, so because of that reason, here I have mentioned it is a bit addressable area as well as byte addressable area. So when these things come into play, when you are going to use these things, see here. Once again, to explain this thing, okay, once again to explain this area, bit addressable and byte addressable area, I am taking the example of our classroom 112 as well as 113. Consider 112 students are 64 and 113 students are 64. Okay, so here I can use this complete 128 bytes in two methods. Okay, here you can see each memory location is having different address. So this memory location is having what address? 00. So last address is what? Last address of memory location is 7f. So that means each memory location is given a specific address. Totally 128 bytes are available. So 64 plus 64 means total how many students are available? 128 students are available. I can use their ID numbers here, and I can, okay, here this, what is the ID number? This address is their ID number, and I can mention here, if the student is absent, I can mark him as 0. If the student is present, I can mark him as 1. So I can use 8 bits here. Okay, how to write those 8 bits? See here, I am considering 0, 0. Okay, this is having 8 bits internally. So I can address if the student by ID number 00H, if he is absent. So what I can write? I can write all zeros in these 8 bits, and I can mention he is absent. Okay. Now consider the 30H address. So this particular student is present. How I can address here? How I can write? I can mention by writing all ones here. If all ones are available here, that means this particular student is present in this particular class. Okay, in this manner I can use all these 128 bytes, but that is not an efficient method to use this memory. Okay, I can use for assignments, I can use all these things for assignment marks, I can use some registers for assignment marks, I can use some for Viva marks or some other purpose. So to use for different purposes, I am using another method. I am using second method. Okay, I am using second method. What is that second method? Bit addressable method. So I am giving rule numbers. Instead of writing ID numbers, I am giving rule numbers to each and every student. So starting from 112 class of 64 students, so the numbers will be 00. Rule number 1 will be for the first person. Okay, first person. Similarly, 00 to 64 will be the rule numbers for first 64 students of 112. And for the second, so I will give the next number 65, 66, 67 up to 128. So 128 rule numbers are available. Okay, so I'm going to explain this thing in a different manner. I will take the practical example. See here, CRs will understand this thing very, very easily. So in general, what they will do in our class, how I will take attendance in general, we will adopt smart attendance. Okay, out of 128 students, suppose 4 students are absent. So what is the best method? Instead of writing 124 presents, what is the smartest method? Simply you identify the 4 absentees. Okay, simply you identify 4 absentees. So that thing will be used by our CRs. They will take the attendance and simply will mention absentees, and they will mention the roll numbers of those absentees. Okay, that is the smartest way of taking attendance. In a similar way, see here, consider I have given how many bytes are available here. 16 bytes are available in this area, and each byte is having how many bits? 8 bits. Okay, so 16 into 8, it will be having 128 bits. So each bit will be carrying the roll number of student. Okay, 113 and 112. So totally 128 students are available. So I am using the first person roll number of first person to I am using this location for that particular candidate. So the second roll number, the person which who is given second roll number, will be his position will be in this bit. Okay, similarly 1F, similarly 20212 up to 2F, 30312 3F, similarly up to 70 to 7F. Consider 01 is absent, 1F is absent, and 7F is absent. So what is the best method? So instead of writing 0000 to indicate the absentee, I am using only that particular candidate absent. Who is absent here now? 01 is absent. Okay, this 01 is absent. I am marking him as absent by setting this only bit as 0. So how to select this bit? Okay, you can select this bit as set B. What address? Set B to 0H. Set B to 0H. Okay, set B 01. Okay, set B 01 of this particular address, then what will happen? Only this particular bit will be selected and he will be marked as absent. Suppose you are selecting 1F. So set B absent means clear, absent. So CLR 1F. CLR 1F means it will be given as 0. Similarly, 7F student is absent. So what I can write? CLR 7F. So what will happen? This particular person will be marked as absent. Okay, now I think this is very clear. So this is how I am effectively trying to use the memory locations. So to effectively use this part, I am going for bit addressability. Okay, but you may get a doubt, but you may get a question. Sir, you have marked 7F as 0. You have 7F here. Okay, 7F address here as well as 7F address here. So how you are differentiating these things? Okay, so the answer for this is, So for this thing, you need to go for, you need to understand this thing. Okay. So totally, how many instructions are available in our microcontroller? Totally, 111 instructions are available. Okay. Out of that, 99 are byte addressable instructions and 12 instructions are bit addressable instructions. So for, what are the 99 byte addressable instructions? Move A comma R naught, or add A comma R naught, subtract A comma R naught. So these are the instructions, byte addressable instructions. And bit addressable instructions are different. See, what are those instructions? Set B, you will mention the address 01H, set B 7FH, clear 7FH, clear 01H, complement CMP 01H. So when I am mentioning the instruction here, so I am using only these instructions. When I am using only these instructions and some consider 7FH, 7FH, or the examples are available here, set F 00H, then that means 00 roll number, okay, bit addressable area, 00 roll number will be selected and that particular bit will be marked as 0. Okay, when I am selecting set B 01H, so roll number 01 will be selected in this area. Okay, what will happen? Set B means only this, set B 01H means this particular instruction is indicating that you are selecting a bit, set B, that is what bit addressable instruction. So it will go to this address and it will mark as 0. Suppose you have selected move A comma 7F, move A comma 7F, so which 7F? Definitely you are going to select this 7F, because move A comma 7F, that is byte addressable instruction, that means you are operating on a byte. So which one will be, which address will be selected? This 7 will be selected. See once again, okay, total 111 instructions are available. Out of that, 99 are byte addressable, 12 are bit addressable. So what are those bit addressable? So these are bit addressable, set B, clear B, complement, clear. Okay, some other instructions are available, you will see in instruction set. So if you are using set B7FH, okay, set B7FH, what will happen, sir? 7FH means set B, so bit addressable instruction means this particular bit will be selected, it will be set to 1. That means that particular student with roll number 7F is present. Okay, now coming to move A comma 7F, then what happens, sir? You have selected a byte addressable instruction, that means you have selected this address, so it will be clearly differentiating roll number as well as ID numbers. Okay, that means bit addressable you can differentiate with the help of instruction, bit instruction, and you can differentiate that by byte instruction. Clear? I think it is very, very clear. Okay, now the last thing, which comes into our internal structure is what? So first section is what? Bank section. Second section is bit addressable section as well as byte addressable section. Third section is general purpose RAM, or it is also called basic RAM, or is also called ordinary RAM, or it is also called scratch pad. Okay, now so to understand this thing, I will explain to you about stack. So what you have learned about stack in 8086, what is stack first? Stack is a part of memory. Where you can expect this stack? Stack will be available in RAM or it will be available in ROM. What is your answer? So the answer is definitely stack will be available in RAM, because definitely in stack you will be writing with the help of push instruction and you will be reading that content with the help of pop instruction. That reading and writing feasibility is available in RAM, not in ROM. Hence it is clear that you are using your stack is available in RAM. But where it is available? Okay, to understand that part, I will explain the concept of RAM first. What is RAM, sir? What is stack? Stack uses what concept? LIFO, last in first out concept, I have explained with the help of books, okay, and placing the duster over that. So what comes in last, it will go out first. Okay, now so I will take some practical examples. In your mobile phone you will be having a message folder. Okay, the last received message will be displayed first, so that is what your message folder is, nothing but your stack. So the last message which is received will be shown first. Okay, so that is, so last in will be read first, so that concept is what stack concept. So in your Facebook, so last notification will be displayed first. In a similar way, in your Instagram also, the last message you have received or last notification or last tweet you have received or last tweet will be displayed first. So all these things will be using the concept of stack here. So what is happening here in stack, I will explain here. So consider this is the top of the stack SP. Now what happens if a new message is if I want to write the new message here, where I can write? I can't write on this XX. So what will happen if you write here? This data will be overwritten. So to avoid that, what will happen? Stack will increment by one, and then the message will be written here. Okay. See what is the difference here? Here this SP is incremented by one, but in our processor SP will be incremented by two. Why? Because it is available in internal RAM, and the stack pointer here it is 8-bit register, but in our 8086 the stack is of 16-bit. There, because of that reason, SP is a 16-bit register in 8086. That will be incremented by 2. SP plus 2 will take place. But here in our microcontroller, stack pointer is 8-bit register. So because of that reason, what will happen? It will increment by 1. Similarly, if you want to read the message, okay, you want to read the message, what will happen? You will read the message. This comes out. Okay. What is available now? So to point that, our stack will be decrementing by 1. So it is very clear. So you are very familiar with this push and pop instructions. Okay, nothing to worry about this. But so from these discussions, you have understood that the stack should start from last. Okay, it will start from the bottom. It will move upwards. Okay, you have understood this point. You should start from bottom and you should go upwards. So whatever you are writing, temporary data or temporary programs will be stored here, okay, written, okay, and if you want to read them, it comes out from the last program or last data will be come out first, okay. So in this fashion, you are starting the stack from bottom and you are moving upwards. So if I want more RAM area, where the stack pointer should available, where the stack pointer should be present, okay. So if I want to use more stack area, so I should have my stack pointer should be at a very very lower address. So the default address for our stack is 07H. Okay, so you can use, it's up to you. Okay, but the efficient method to use our stack pointer is 07H. So you can understand, you can do move operations, add operations, subtract operations using these registers. Okay, these registers, it's up to you. You can use or you may not use. Okay, so because of that reason, the best location for a stack pointer is 07H. Okay, you may shift this. It's up to you. It's based on your demand. If you are using more number of registers, you can set this stack pointer to 1F or you can place it to 2F. It's up to you. So what is the example, sir? I can use this 1F, so it's up to me. Okay, so generally in any mobile phone, the call icon, okay, the calling icon will be placed on the bottom and leftmost. The leftmost bottom left hand side will be your calling icon, because the primary purpose of your mobile phone is for calling, okay, for communication. So it is feasible, it is usable for every person. He will be holding the mobile and the thumb will go directly on the left hand side, leftmost calling icon. So some people may use only messages, so you may shift the calling icon. You will be replacing that with message. You can replace with your WhatsApp. So in a similar manner, it's up to the programmer. You can shift this SP, you can start using your stack from 20, or you can start using from 30. It's up to you. Okay, one more thing, I have selected stack pointer, the best method. The designer has mentioned that the stack pointer's best address will be 07H. Okay, so why, sir? So this 07 may be overwritten. Will this R7 register will be overwritten? No, sir. Why? If you want to write some content in this, what you will do first, it will pre-increment. Pre-increment will happen and then writing operation will take place. So what you will do, you will increment SP by SP plus 1. So this memory location 08 will be available. And now you will push the contents in R0 of bank 1. So because of that reason, you are not disturbing R7 register of bank 0. So I think the concept regarding this RAM and ROM, everything is very, very clear. So with this our topic ends. So if you have any doubts, please ask the questions without any hesitation. Okay, I am ready to answer your questions.